This is the first major complication, right?
From my tour.
Okay. So, for all of you who are present here, you have to make yourself sound like 10 people when we start the recording, because we want to make people really jealous of themselves not being here. Alright, so when I count down from 5, you're going to start clapping and cheering like nobody's business. You got this? Alright. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Oh yeah! Oh! Right on.
Welcome to Writing Night. Thank you, everyone. You are an amazing 100 people who are here. Thank you. I am Skylar Bruce. I will be your host for tonight. Azra Johnson, founder of Writing Nights, is present over here. He's running tech this evening. So where is the best place to write?
Here.
Who are the best people to write?
Us.
And the best time to write is?
Now.
What was that, Josh?
Eventually. What?
I heard something that was interesting, so. All right. Very good. Well, we're very glad to have you all here, because we have both two really awesome featured performers, and we have something totally new and different, the sword fight. Oh, and I know you're all excited for that. Give it up for the sword fight. Yay! Let's see here. The theme for this month is transition. To celebrate that transition, you know, we already talked about the sword fight between J.M. Romig and Jamie Laubacher. Give him another hand. We have a double sword play by those two for sale. Also, both fighters have their own copies to buy from, so buy from them first before you buy from Writing Nights, which is in the back. Grand Showcase is in 14 days. Alright, sponsors are USA Quick Print and Rebel Salmon Media, aka Johnny Haboo, who we all know and love, and Arts and Stark. July 27th, 7 to 9 p.m. right here at Makeshift Makerspace. That is a Friday. And then Saturday, we're going to have three programs, Icon Gallery here, Makeshift Makerspace, and Avenue Arts, as well as vendors up and down Court Street over here from 3rd to 6th. So a lot of the area that you're already familiar with from coming to First Friday. Okay, so our first performer describes themselves as an expert soul diver, revealer of fuckboys, LGBTQ plus activist. Give it up for Paul Magnus.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Oh, let me get used to this. Sorry for being antisocial, but I just went to Panini's and my stomach hurts, so that's why I hid in the corner. So before I dive into Punk Boys, the very first poem I'm going to read, it's called One Night Storm. This is actually a new poem. There was a breeze, and all the air ran in. A flash of lightning that no one saw except me. I hate how the shortest moments are the most bright. how the darkness rushes to fill their place when they dissipate. I'm surprised nothing flooded from the wave he rode in on. Rain poured from the ceiling, and it felt as if I had touched water for the first time. There's something about being submerged in someone else's presence. He wore my clothes and asked to sleep in my bed. There's something about how in a single receding wave, I was left drier than I was before. His water mixed with my air effortlessly. We were such a lovely storm. It came and then it was over, never to be discussed again. Not even a whisper, not even a cloud. And give me 2 minutes as I open up this on my phone. I can sing elevator music, but you probably don't want me to.
We've got the Jeopardy theme song if we need
it. Oh. This first one's called Twinks for Sale / Bed Enthusiast, and this is the opener. It's all about giving in, then giving up, before you become a contortionist, before you get turned into a pretzel, before you pretend to like it. Instead of giving men your heart, start giving them numbers, like a ticket dispenser in the deli section. They'll all start pulling at your meat. Going halvesies is all the way, and you'll learn how to defend yourself with whisks and knives from wives whose husbands gave in to your temptation, even though they're the ones who came on to you. Give up the notions of monogamy. Give up the notions of marriage. There is not a single man in this universe that won't fold you into something hideous and demeaning. You don't have to be anonymous. You don't have to give them your name. But while those bed slats keep breaking, remember, you cannot easily revert to being tame. Here we go, here's some funny. Cats are assholes.
Yeah.
Woo. That's what I'm like.
Yep.
In the midst of suffocating on cigarette and cannabis smoke every weekend, alcohol spiraling through our veins like ivy, the house became a wilderness, with cat included, because how can any true wild exist without the presence of a pussy that walks in directly via the front door, looks you dead in the face with his porcelain feline stare? Green eyes claw hook your own as you remember Minette Nichols' paw beckoning for attention. You pet the pussy. We all pet the pussy. But the pussy only wants your affection for the evening, so he follows you to your room, sits on the bed once you sit down, lays on his back with his stomach open. You scratch behind the pussy's ears, stroke his ego just a wee bit harder than anyone else. It's 4 a.m. before you're done toying with the pussy. The pussy is as tired as you are, and eyes your bed as a resting ground. You tell the pussy no, but the pussy does what the pussy wants. Until you suggest the couch, only the couch. He wraps himself to sleep instantaneously and stays there. You wake him up by saying, it's 3 p.m. The pussy yawns and runs out the door. A day passes before he accepts your friend request on Facebook. Just to find out he has a relationship with another owner. You know you won't see the pussy again, and you mutter to yourself, cats aren't pussies, they're assholes. Do you want some like half poetry, half rap action?
Sure.
All right.
This one's older. It's called There Are Earthquakes Often. This is when I lived in my house next to university, and it's basically a trap house. Lamp was suicidal, jumping off dresser when monitor models toward me. Thunder in the second largest bedroom. Heads mattress in the cloud. 2 bodies hit the ground. Bones bumping on the floor. This house has no skeleton, only air ducts where the most hated creatures go to die. Smell the air, it'll get you higher. Cough out a lung. Everyone's got one to spare around here. Don't walk through the front door, throw through the side door. It's unlocked like our bedrooms, unless it's his room. Then get ready for a shake from the quake with an epicenter feet away. There are satisfying screams in the hallway. No, than mine. I'm not lonely, only frustrated. Pounding is knocking on the periods right out of my fucking bone. Ball. feels wrong. He was a cyborg out of commission. He laid in my bed with his pecs on hinge. I tried to repair his mechanisms, but I knew nothing about his inner workings. There was no manual to a person. How can one fix a machine if they don't even know how to sustain it? My fingers were wrenches, but the only thing they could clasp was his heart bob. Thumping red blooms scrolled through my glass. I squeezed until its shape gave way. The only tears that fell were from my bleeding palm into his chest cavity. Glass shards crumpled in my fist. I busted all the love he had for me. He rebooted, then screamed. Our world became white noise. I left us scathed, the price to pay for being the heartbreaker. How much time do I have left?
Keep going.
Okay.
Keep going until you're done.
Okay. So part of the reason I even wrote Fuckboys was to get into just the rape culture in America and dissect that a little bit. And I had my own rape experience about 2 years ago, and it took me a whole year to get through. So these next two poems are dedicated to that. The first one's called Micro Tears. The body does not say yes when the mind says no. Instead it lies. There, like an open capsule, packing in the pain you'll scream out when no one is listening. The pain you wish you could have swallowed in the moment your body didn't belong to you. This one's called The Boy Who Drew Knives. Five sections. One. There's still a bruise from when I smacked my leg on his bedpost. It never faded, like his reputation for being a psycho that carries knives. I should have ran when he swayed a blade behind his back, but it was an intimate moment, waiting for him to poke at me. Two. I'm always the lockbook without a key, but he sliced my spine and slid a few pages in. Where was the warning? He called me a masochist, then silenced my jaw with soft chokes. He told me that I liked it. Three. The one time I made myself vulnerable was the last time I let false trust push into me. It doesn't take many friends to let you know you've made a mistake. His groping hands had grabbed all who were close to me like a parasite looking to infect a whole colony. How could I justify being the original carrier? Four. He is a minister of desecration, and I feel defiled. Part of me wishes the experience was an illusion, like sticking two white tabs under your tongue and watching geometric shapes pulse on the ceiling. Even paper knives can cut you at the right angle. Five. The best part about the summer was the fireflies, because when they're smashed, their bodies still glow the same color, which is more honesty than I'll ever receive from a boy who draws knives. They would land on my shoulders, guiding me through the darkness of clasped hands that once held me in place. I think I'm gonna do two more. If Raining Blood would bring us back to life, I would sit on rooftops pulling feathers out of cardinals. Let cascading plumes brush away some of our strife, lashed onto your eyebrows that curl and twist whenever an augmented word crawls out of my mouth like an arachnid. For a man so afraid of spiders, why did you come to a house encased in webs? We're caught in a Chinese finger trap. I don't want you to get closer to you than I already am. How about we put our conjoined hands on a table saw to see who loses a limb first? Or we play limbo and see who's willing to go the lowest while contorting the other's arm. Either way, this union is an out-of-control boxing match. One of us is going to be bloody and on the ground. The maelstrom turns over and over. There's no cooking on my stove because all the pilot lights are out. My hands are colder than dry ice kept in your mouth for too long. I don't remember who purged the heat, but I can't feel butterflies in my stomach unless I hand crank them. Like the black circles around my eyes are just spinning, spinning. I can't stop the turnover from day to night, this half-light that feels as if a shadow fell but didn't reach its destination. My hurt pulses as you sit with me in a whirlpool, and I watch as I am the stone that resists the pool. Thank you for having me, and thank you for listening. Go on, awesome.
What's that?
Yeah, I'm gonna fix that.
Tape fixes everything.
Well, just wait till you get older. Well, duct tape fixes some things that WD-40 doesn't fix.
Hey, they saved a space mission with duct tape and a sock, so.
Okay. Alrighty, so I should tell you that all of our monthly shows will have some sort of theme. And then there should be a flyer around here somewhere for me to read those off of. But I don't have it. So yeah, tonight's theme is transition, and as you can see, we are transitioning really hard. So yeah, transitions aren't always, you know, neat, clean, and pretty, but you know, sometimes you just gotta get there. So while Azrael is getting that for me, August, the theme is hot summer night. Gee, I wonder why. It's going to be cold then. September is falling into autumn. And does Azrael have any more themes selected?
October is spooky verses.
Spooky verses. Not spooky purses. I make those, but no. Okay, let's see here. Fast forwarding a little in time. Apparently our November 2nd Friday theme will be hunger. And we're going to, Azrael and Vertigo, I think, are going to do some sort of a poetry for food publication as well. So people who bring in canned goods and other things to contribute to the hunger cause will be able to get that book. So if you want to contribute to that book, like to put, maybe have your words in it, talk to Azrael. So that will be a special foreplay that they'll be doing, and that was all for that particular announcement. All right, our next performer is a frequenter of Writing Nights events, author of Electric Company by Writing Nights. Please welcome to the staging area, John Burroughs.
Thank you so much. I'm thrilled to be here among you, and I very much enjoyed the fine young man who came before me, and I'm looking forward to being sword fight as well. I will start with a poem from my latest chapbook, which is entitled Lost and Foundering. Sweet Melissa. In my city of lost places, Melissa is on the ventilator a year to the day after Jerry was removed, and I will not know for two more days. It was just 2 weeks ago she declined to attend my Sandusky reading because she had pneumonia, when she did not know it was really stage 4 lung cancer. In my city of lost places, they are now removing her breathing tube, and I have not seen Melissa since 2004 at a corner store on Prospect in Elyria, and we have not commingled since more than 10 years before that. It was just too difficult with one of us in prison and both of us married to admit ourselves emotionally conjoined since she had been my first turn-on to poetry, King Crimson, and LSD. In my city of lost places, I remember her telling me about her dead twin, Vanessa, who she claimed to be while pretending Melissa was the one who had died in infancy. It was just two sides of one woman, though. Like the one who made her children stay in their room so I could put her ankles next to her ears years after the one who had bloodied my back in childless ecstasy. In my city of lost places, I want to go see her before she is no more. But for the past year, since she sent a card to Jerry's funeral, she's been afraid to let me see her, instead mailing me a 12-year-old photo to scan and return. And anyway, I don't want to make anything more difficult. In my city of lost places, a poem that will do Melissa justice eludes me. So I play my favorite Allman Brothers song on repeat. Remember the advent of my poetry and mourn the imminent over and over. Sybil. Ares is my brother, building an illegal bonfire in my suburban backyard. Taurus is my mother, the origin of my poesy, bequeathing me her incongruous bull horns. Gemini is a roller coaster, mirror hook and grommet, full soar and plummet. Cancer nips at my back. Leo is a manly masseuse, loosing regal courage where and when I least expect. Virgo is an exacting secret. Libra scales a mountain of excrement, finding balance at its summit. Scorpio is my adoptive father, stinging the air, my bottom now out of reach. Sagittarius prances deftly over my head, a thought balloon keeping would-be backstabbers at bay, while Capricorn philosophizes disaster away. Aquarius yearns to be a fortunate oasis, while Pisces fishes for homeostasis. And they all revolve around me, the astrologer, brilliant in my white dress, gleaming relationship and illumination from the universal night. From Genesis to Exodus, after Prince Rogers Nelson. In the beginning, there was God, and God was much more than a B-side to Purple Rain, the single before I Would Die For You. God was the one I called faggot in high school several years before I knew better and became a true believer and pansexual. God was ubiquitous on MTV the summer I entered the Marine Corps at 17 and exited the Marine Corps still 17. Dazed. You're gonna have to fight your own damn war. God was there, purple on screen during my first blowjob at the appropriately named Tower Drive-In. And he was always there on my clock radio in Wilkes Villa, seen and known, unseen and unknowable, in my homeless backpack in Cascade Park, plugged into the table cassette player at the Lorain County Community College Library, and in the background, as I went down for the first time on Cassie's Raspberry Hooray. God was still there, a prince of a man, as I made it through college, cut off my wannabe Jerry curl, took a job at the gay bar, lost and found my identities again and again, and even went through enforced sobriety and concrete cell walls, I watched 1999 come and go and raved unto the joy monastic. Joan Osborne asked, what if God was one of us? And he was. And he walked among us. And often we knew him not, especially when he became Jehovah's Witness and exorcised his songs from YouTube and bought into chemtrail conspiracy theories, Percocet pantomimes, and a fentanyl flatline. Because living can be painful even when you're God. Especially when you're God. And in the 21st century, God was still here with us, even as TMZ declared him dead. And though I live on Alphabet Street, no song of mine can capture his new power glory. I love you more than I did when you were mine. Inner Expedition. Unscrewing the spaces. Hardware in roof beam, scream lines in silence, time live in electronic mime, verbiage nonverbal by design. Take rake, hammer, and pull. Avoid torn skin, wool. Leap, light, lick at window. Unguru, sinew. Exposed. This is a poem from my Ready Nights chapbook, Electric Company.
Ready Nights.
I am very proud of. I wrote this poem after LeBron James left the first time. Tell them I am sent you. I am sitting next to words I can't hear. Hearing words I can't sit next to. Daydreaming, nearly nodding. I still reach to my right, grab a random book from the shelf, notice its Ferlinghetti title, Wild Dreams of a New Beginning. Open it at random to page 22/23. I am now, contemplating my great effort to break away from using gerunds, realizing how difficult it can be. To resume, recalling that point 22 is a gun, that 23 was a cavalier small forward and famed bull shooting guard. Putting the book back on its black shelf with Homer and Frost, distracted by deep impressions, depressed to my distraction, I unsuccessfully resist an impulse to rhyme with satisfaction. This poem is not really disintegrating. I am still now. Okay, I want to read a new poem that I don't think I've read anywhere before, so it needs work, but here you go. It was kind of inspired by the prompt was that thing that was going around Facebook where you post the number one song on your 14th birthday, whatever that might be. And so my poem is entitled, Odd Missive. Dear whomever it may concern, I have always felt upside down and downside up. Like an hourglass or a cup tumbling down a mountain of valleys. Like an alley full of endless avenues and dead-end streets. Like a meetup nobody comes to. Or a voice recorder in a landfill. I have always felt like a number one Diana Ross song on my 14th birthday. Upside Down. But also her subsequent single, I'm Coming Out. I have always felt outside in. And insight out. But never insight in unless I was mistaken. Or outside out unless my heart was breaking and I could no longer bear the indoors. I have always felt like a rooftop floor or a basement ceiling. Like a numb feeling or the unreeling business of a wordproof letter. Like an ungotten go-getter. A colander filled with holy water. Like an arid pants wetter. A desert detour, an albino moor. The kind of hello who is talking to himself again, to whomever it may concern, even when it concerns only him, or not even. How odd. Sincerely, Miss Civ. And I have one more. This is the bookend to the first poem I read. Unfounded. In this city of lost places, my 15-year-old granddaughter is no longer hiding all the places she cuts herself to hide all the places she hurts. I imagine it's because she does not want to die, and the cutting makes her feel alive, or because she feels dead inside, or like hell. I can only speculate why, because she will not tell. In my city of lost places, there are 6 urns, 2 wooden boxes, a metal canister, and 3 fancier ones from the funeral home, full of ashes and bone bits. Our dogs Lucky and Lady, her 18-year-old cat Cricket, my mother-in-law, sister-in-law Sherry, and wife Jerry Lynn, because I cannot bear to bury them. In my city of lost places, there is a light that never goes out. And there is an out that never gets lit. And there is an it that never gets fought. And there is a fit that never gets sought or wrought. In my city of lost places, the oyster is my world until it is not anymore. And sometimes still is. And there is a this that cannot be that. And there is an at that cannot be bliss. And it seems all things are hurting and healing and feeling like cutting themselves. In my city of lost places, a seamstress has come undone. A teacher has failed to master the lesson, and a doctor has caught his death. I imagine it's because she does not want to live, and the cutting makes her feel dead, or loved inside, or like hell. I can only speculate and expectorate why when I do not know. In my city of lost places, it's the first anniversary of my wife's death. Her clothing is still in our dresser and hanging in my closet. and the black framed family photo collage from her hospital room still sits in my living room on her former makeup table. And her makeup is still in my bathroom with her tweezers and scissors and razor, and whatever has not yet been cut is torn apart. And I feel her with me and not, and realize sometimes it's easiest to love your mate unconditionally when she no longer expects anything of you.
That too. Definitely tomorrow as well. All right. We're going to take a 5-minute break to get ready for the first ever sword fight. So if you're watching on Facebook Live, hang tight. We'll be right back. If you are here and you have not yet paid your $5 for this incredible experience, please make sure you do that. And we'll also be happy to relieve your money afterwards too, but now is an even better time.
All right.
So, Kristen, the stage is setting itself. And we'll be right back in 5 minutes.
All right, Josh and James, do you want to have chairs on stage or do you want to stand? Doesn't that matter to me?
Can I have a chair to sit?
Yeah, you can do that. Okay. Hold on, I'm not sure if it's going to take a good job on that.
What about like those command hooks that Velcro? I mean, it wouldn't work tonight,
sure.
But you could have some on the back and then you just remove the ones from the wall.
All right.
So
really,
we have to go to the bathroom.
Okay. Well, for when we're not standing.
Yeah, it'll be popcorn style. So if you
have
the open mic,
we should say that.
Jamie, will you sit down for a second on that chair?
Talk to Azure afterwards.
Beautiful. Okay, cool. Thank you.
We need 3 chairs behind here.
Yeah.
Aren't those cute? Yes.
Seemed like a good day to show my solidarity.
Well, they're distinct. They're definitely distinct.
Got them on shoes.com.
Nice. I can never buy shoes online.
I was afraid to, but they were such a good price, I thought, I'm going to give them a try. And they had a guarantee if you returned them, so.
That's hard to argue with. Mine are wide across here with a really narrow heel. Nothing fits. Sandals are good.
Yeah.
Oh, for the days when we all had shoes custom made, that was the standard.
Oh, you know what? They used to, you don't have to go back very far in Michigan. When we didn't have left and right.
Yeah, so all you're going to do is show you the museum in Kansas City. The one
and
you think is better than around, you're going to give it 10.
Yep.
The less good one, we'll give it 9 or less.
Shoes are so interesting.
Yeah.
They are.
So it's 3 rounds. So, if you look here. You keep them private, and no one, you don't have to write your name on it. You can write, so let's see.
Rooting general.
Round 10, maybe 9.
Now that I see this,
you just happen to have one with you.
Okay.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Want,
I'm surprised it's actually kind of cool. So I came in the car for so long. I had it in the trunk. And this is insulated.
It's gold, and so you should be good.
Yep. Well, one of us does the brag.
You could just find out. You announced initially you and Tori.
Oh, but I mean, they don't forget. You know, they get the
one. Yeah, Facebook Live is going. There was some like red thing that happened. It's
brutal.
Like,
no.
Dollars.
Thank you, Bill.
Thanks, Bill.
Thanks, buddy.
Also not required to memorize, and there's also no musical accompaniment.
And unlike some slam things, there actually is no grace period for the time, so when you're done, you're just done.
At 10 seconds till the end, I will knock on something, and then you'll know you have 10 seconds left.
And so the judges have already been briefed on the scoring, but basically it's a 10-point system, so if the winner of the round gets 10 points, the loser has to get 9 points or less. And if a judge cannot decide between the two, they may award both fighters a 10, but this should be very rare. Despite the use of characters and personas, all scores given are legitimate and will determine future storylines. So, I should introduce our judges this evening. We have Tori. Give it up for Tori. And give it up for Molly. Judges, so we appreciate that you've decided to get your judging faces on and do this thing with us. Okay, let's see, where am I in this? Okay, so, yes, in this corner, weighing in on the purpose of purpose, on the meaning of meaning, author of We Are Made of Found Objects, and Writing Night's own Break Wall to Break Wall, the procrastinator in chief, the Buddha of bullshit. Your loudmouth liberal friend on Facebook, please welcome J.M. Robbins! And in this corner, not really corner, more of a space, weighing in at 20 pounds, 5.5 by 5 inches weight, that's printer paper. Champion of unwritten chapbooks, patron saint of passionate abstinence, and queen of emotional quandaries, all the way from the exotic city of Akron, Ohio, please welcome Jamie Lovemother! And for, you know, numbers' sake, it's really great if we would have a third judge. So is there...
Hi, Facebook. Hi, Yoli.
How can we be sure this is not going to be biased? We were supposed to go against each other.
You know, that's what happens with doctors. They tell you you're going to be out for this long, and then you only end up being out for half of it.
Woo! Yay, recovery! Woo!
And I'm the most qualified person here to take that seat. So, you know, I wouldn't go that far. See, as a judge, I do have to be impartial. And I mean, I appreciate your enthusiasm, but see, I already know who I want to win. And they better win. Because I don't associate with losers, okay? So, how about we get on with this?
All right, so we're going to get on with it, as we do. We're going to do a coin flip to see who goes first. Azra has a coin.
There's a coin.
Okay. Let's see here. So whoever goes first in round one goes second in round two, and then third in round three. No, that's not the way it is. And then we do another coin flip for round three. All right, so who wants to call it? All right, you want heads or tails?
Tails.
Okay.
It is
tails. Alright, so Jamie's gonna go first. Go for Jamie. Alright, so one mouth. Round one is 2 minutes for each fighter. And there's an optional thing on here too.
Just start the round.
Okay, this is for after that. Okay, got it. Oh. Sorry. This is the thing too.
Technical difficulties.
There you go. Okay, so Jamie is going to be first in this round, and I think as soon as Azrael is able to find a stopwatch on there.
Where is it?
Go back to the main screen and then push the clock.
Clock, got it. Yeah. Cool.
Clock, and it should already be up.
Yes.
Okay. All right, please welcome Jamie!
Is the clock going right now?
No, because I figured our first time we wouldn't be that stringent. Okay. So just tell me when you're ready to start, and then I'll start.
I'm ready when you are.
Okay. Go.
Lifestyle blogs. Holy, holy focused, hocus pocus style incantations or meditations. Self-medicating with the mint and ginger ground on my kitchen, counteracting the stinging left in my eyes when I turn off my computer every night. These are the things I try. Mornings, I keep quiet, search my lawn for leftover scraps of midnight, race the light rising over the hill, harness as much intention as my dopamine-deprived mind can muster towards manifesting something. Something like a sonnet or a new soup recipe, pieced together from whatever resisted molding in my fridge. I live in fear of not living enough, grasp at lifestyles and straws and some coveted feeling of fulfillment I'm half convinced is only a fantasy. But I have to keep tailoring myself into something, because thoughts left untrimmed grow thorns. So I list off nutrition facts, the light preferences of different houseplants, the metaphysical traits of crystals, names of authors I may or may not have read, a litany invoked before bed each night in the hope of rising again tomorrow, feeling better and more and more and more and more. Oh, poor Atlas. Our love was a beast of burden on your shoulders, so I've heard. Man who thinks himself a mystic chose the wrong myth. Huh. No, Atlas, there was only Echo, crying your name over and over until she faded. A note can only sound so long once strings are no longer plucked. Man who thinks himself a musician didn't understand why the song ended, was surprised to hear it written as a duet. What is it to walk out of a haunted house? What is it to walk out of a fog towards something solid? Who wouldn't need a string to guide them out of a labyrinth if they've been led to the middle and left? You see
here.
That's for the crap out of me, Azra.
That's authoritative.
Yes.
Yes, well, I know what to expect the next time.
Yes.
Although Josh is not going to do the same thing, is he?
You're not going to go over time.
No. No, she didn't go over time. She was good.
All right, so for the second part of round one, please welcome up here, J.M. Robbins!
Alright, let me know when you're ready.
Ready.
Alright. Aging millennial blues. My feet ache, my back aches, my heart aches from this overtime. 50 hours this week still won't make ends meet, let alone put a dent in my debt. But the boomers I work with won't let me forget that my generation got participation trophies. Oh, please, spare me. I can't even with you, so I won't. I'm entitled to say, you get to retire, I don't. I've been 34 years in these bones, and it's gonna take 79 more to pay off my student loans. But I'm still beating my feet against the concrete floor, still breaking myself and asking for more, still scraping by with the help of a roommate, my parents, or a side hustle or four. I'm getting too old for all this running around. I can't play, shit's different now. I don't even know the game anymore. I mean, people selling shit on Facebook now. What happened to eBay? Or word of mouth? The heck is a Snapchat? The fuck is a Cash App? I can't keep up, I've been out. And phones are all touchscreens now, can't even fit them in my pocket. What is this? Man, I miss my sliding keyboard. Woo!
Got a minute. Got a minute.
Okay, I have it prepared for a different one.
Okay.
I also miss my sliding keyboard. Very much.
Okay. Who's in their 30s here?
You can be an honorary 30-something.
I'm almost there.
Alright, so we're obviously having a lot of fun tonight. So I want to ask Jamie, how do you feel about the first round?
I feel fantastic.
Awesome. And JM, how do you feel?
Pretty good.
Pretty good. Okay, don't oversell it or anything.
Tell us how you really feel.
How are the judges feeling? The judges good? Any questions?
I think we're doing pretty good.
Okay, very good. And how was the audience tonight?
All right.
All right, let's move on to round two. So
in this one, JM will go first and Jamie will go second. I don't think there's any other interludes that were needed. So, JM, come on up
all
here.
Right, back up. All right. Woo! All American. All right. Let me know when I'm ready.
Go.
All right. I am all American. As American as apple pie flavored hookah smoke, candy coated cancer sticks, double cheeseburgers, bacon vodka, and quick fix diets. I am all American. As American as county fairs, as elephant ears, cotton candy, tractor pulls, and country music. As American as block parties, ice cream trucks, backyard barbecues, sidewalk chop, hip-hop, and hopscotch. I am all American. As American as success stories, as montages set to classic rock and triumphant underdogs. As American as ramen noodles for lunch, as late rent, as eviction notices, locked doors, and keys that no longer open them. As stray dogs begging for their lives as the city puts them down. I am all American. As American as Saturday morning cartoons and Sunday mass. As mass murder in public schools. I am all American as Monday morning announcements and moments of static silence. I am all American as booming Silicon Valley and crumbling Detroit. As American as the moon landing and the Trail of Tears. As American as slave-owning freedom fighters founding our nation. I am all American, as Americans hunger strikes and hunger pains. As American is hope that persists against all costs and escape at all costs. I am all American, as American is Southern hospitality, police brutality, colorblindness, blind spots, and political incorrectness. As American as trigger warnings and trigger fingers. I am all American, as American is stop and frisk policies, as dead children, as grieving mothers, as white-hot guilt sitting corrosive inside an officer's gut, as American as I swear to God I thought he had a gun. I am all American is dreadlocks and mullets, as deadbolts and bullets, as fireworks and drone strikes. I am free and in debt, I am privileged and yet left wanting, I am a patchwork quilt of the world's scraps. A union divided in more ways than there are breaths in a lifetime. Parts of it are ugly, but you will not want to look away. No, you will want to look away, but you should not. Isn't it beautiful how it constantly seems to be on the verge of falling apart, but somehow manages to hold itself together? You see, I am all American.
You got 30 seconds.
30
seconds,
woo!
Alright.
I have everything
off. The best part of that was Jamie's look
on
her face with the
sign falling down. The wall got tired of
you. Oh my god. Oh, damn.
Yeah,
right.
Oh my
god.
Well, give it up again for J.M. Romick.
Alright.
In my cupboard, I asked the spoons in my drawer whether you existed. They remind me of the steam that rose from my hair when I burned all your pictures. I find one that I missed, tucked into a book under my bed. We never looked good in pictures, could never coordinate our smiles. I take a lighter to us over the sink and then lay myself out in the sun to dry a little faster. This one's for JM. Small. You have become the sick, soft feeling of gums left bare of pulled teeth, the slow mineral leaching of a deficiency, every regrettable metaphor stuck into a stanza like a kick-me sign on a middle schooler's back. But you are not fatal. You are not even stable enough to justify a sick day. You have deteriorated to the thinness of newsprint, ink smearing when I bother to thumb through you. You're a rock not big enough to form a bruise, just taking up space in my shoe, soon to be shaken out and kicked across the concrete. You have become nothing that cannot be forgotten or missed entirely. Tired and stereotypical and small.
You got 20 seconds if you want it.
I feel confident.
Cool.
It's been a while.
I'm afraid I lost your nickel, sorry. It's okay.
Okay. So you have a penny, I think, for the next job?
I have exposed.
You have a quarter? Okay. Yeah, let's flip a quarter for the thing. Oh yeah! Let's pop it up for Jamie! Woo! Did you write that last piece just for this?
A lady never tells. But...
All right, so our third and final round will be 4 minutes per fighter. And we're going to do another coin flip to determine who goes first. So, since Jamie called it last time, Jim, would you like to call it this time?
Heads.
Heads, okay. And it is tails.
Four.
And here's quarterback.
Thank you.
All right, so any clarification, judges, are we good? All right, so please welcome again, Jamie Lovato! Woo!
All right, I'm ready when you are.
Go.
Coffee at 11 p.m. on a Saturday night before teaching Sunday school the following morning. Sitting across from you at our McDonald's, watching your left eye twitch. You look so tired. It's lonely being scary, you say, and ruffle up your mohawk-shaven hair and smack your pack of Marlboros against the table. You tell me about the dirty looks you got from the woman buying lottery tickets at the Circle K down the street. She cashed in her tickets for more tickets and acted like I want to eat her kid. I count the piercings in your face and sigh. We were both raised under the umbrella of their disapproval. Glares, curfews, silence at dinner, silenced in church. But I set up my house behind their lines while you hit the street like the lightning they were always afraid you would become. They never really knew what to look for. Their sight sharpened when their hearing failed. Your character never changed, but your clothes did. Everyone needs to stop, you say. You're tired. You're a shattered Molotov cocktail, but I don't mind stepping around the glass because I know you were almost a message in a bottle, almost a voice to save us all. There's some glue in my back pocket, but I don't think it'll work on you, kid. I can only balance on the lines and tell myself that this is where I'm needed. Mediators are hard to come by here, and who wants to be out of a job? I'm a rumble. Not a flash like you are, but who else would follow in your wake to voice the thoughts you never thought through before you ran too fast and hit the ground? I'd love to strike the lines and turn the power out with you. Town-wide blackout, riot. But one of us has got to survive. And I am less suspicious to them anyway. You smack your pack of Marlboros against the table. I count every piercing in your face and sigh. I've become the girl who orders decaf. Washer dryer hookups. My used underwear and towels swirl shamelessly behind glass for the world to see, sudsy, come to a slow grinding halt, smell like the same detergent your mother always used. While they dry, recall a date in the laundromat, dating back to when what I wore wasn't governed by what was still clean, by whether I had free time on a weekend, back when people were still worth impressing and I kept up with their pace. Count the quarters, as if we would ever not have enough. Divide them between us in our little plastic cups. You'll remember it as novelty, not necessity, when we played at the aesthetic of a lifestyle that would eventually become all I could afford around each month's rent. Back when it felt like an expansion of self to take in the piles of other people's pants, the fish swimming across the 20-year-old wallpaper border and adventure. You were so bent on wanting to feel poor or important, whatever you thought would give your thoughts weight and movement and make your music matter, on appearing unattached to the same material things that made this experience so unique, so singular. How sufficient for a man whose mother still washes his socks for him. How other. Recall the luxury of extra coins for pop and chips from a vending machine that actually worked. One book each. A whole beautiful, unbothered day ahead of us and vibration. The washing, drying rhythm, constant and gentle. A steady train taking us somewhere we still thought we wanted to go.
Thank you, Jamie. Let's clap again for her. I'd like to point out what both JM and Jamie are wearing on their shirts. Celestial bodies of some kind or another. So, you know. All right. So, are we having a good time so far with the sword? You definitely want to do another one next month?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's going to happen. All right. So, for our final 4 minutes of this evening, please welcome Jet and Robin! Woo!
Go.
All right. Time is a funny thing. The days drag on, and the weeks fly by in a blur. The years come faster and faster as yesterdays begin to compress into decades of blurred and fragmented memories, and even these eventually become debris in the wake of time's relentless march forward. And I wonder what the Earth looks like from the point of view of a comet sprinting toward it, just two celestial bodies fated for collision in 20 billion tomorrows. I think about humanity in those early days, and about how suddenly we went from hunting wild beasts with sticks and stones to hunting pizza with mobile phones, from gathering in caves and makeshift huts to watch fire flicker and make children, to gathering on couches in living rooms to binge-watch Netflix and make children. I look up at the sky, at all of the stars, and think, how many of those died long ago, and how long will it take for us to get the memo? And despite all of this deep time thinking, I fail to stop myself from looking down. You see, nothing has changed. Not a minute slips by as I sit here and fidget, just awaiting your reply. Everything that's demonstrated. The newly empty hoarder's house feels lonely. There are clean squares of carpet marking where the boxes were obsessively stacked in neat high towers. And the backyard is full of rain-wooing childhood keepsakes, blurred photographs of ghosts, and too many boxes of ink-bleeding love letters never sent. The highways are littered with stories of what could have been, shattered on the cruel asphalt of this stubborn, perpetual now. We are all the victims of nostalgia, cobbling together a makeshift self from what remains of who we were yesterday, but memory is often misremembered, and history is a book with too many missing chapters and unreliable narrators. Despite our best efforts, we are not at all good at keeping things. The newly emptied hoarder's house feels hopeful. See, the foyer is no longer unusable. You can breathe and not gag on a thick atmosphere of ammonia. The front yard has freshly cut grass for the first time in forever. We can see where a garden can grow. There's a swing set out there with chains that are rusted from years of neglect. But we know it's not unfixable. Nothing is unfixable. We are all survivors of the past, given a choice every day about what to keep and what to throw away. And who we are, today, and what relationship we have with the things left on the endless road behind us. Tomorrow, it's a terrifyingly perfect white page screaming at us, daring us to make some kind of mark upon it. Take up the challenge. Make new, but remember as you do that we are not at all good at keeping things, because things aren't meant to be kept. Send your love letters while there is still love in them. You see, the newlywed's first home feels like possibility.
Thanks. It's up to them. Whatever they want
to
judge with.
So, do judges have any feedback?
Yeah, that's
a good
question.
Yes,
what were
you
thinking today?
I'd
like to
know. I feel that when you judge the competition on the basis of your content and your performance. And, you know, you can have one bad round in a fight and come back strong in the next two and win the fight. So, you know, yeah, Jamie did run over her time in the first round.
But at the same time, you didn't use your time amazingly well.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ouch.
Good feedback.
Any comments, Molly?
Do I have to talk shit?
No, no.
Out of character, but I want to know, just like in case I want to do this again.
That's a great question. I would say that if you only use half your time, you only give us half the amount to go on. That's part of it, and then I think too, there are differences in energy, vibe, kind of delivery. You both had such relatable content, and it was just such like beautiful. Like you both had lots of like words that I was like, oh,
you know.
You're both awesome.
That's what we awesome.
So I was kind of going on whichever one I connected to more, which was sometimes energy, sometimes delivery, sometimes topic. It just it kind of changed, but whichever one kind of resonated with me more.
Okay, good to know.
What's that
message? Oh, yes. Is there any feedback that anyone wants to share? Yes, Bridget.
So that poem, the first one you gave Jamie, probably I thought the best poem I had ever heard in my life until I heard the one that he gave about the 30s.
So close.
That's the best poem I ever heard.
Just for a second.
I was going to say the last one, it's so left. The second best poem I've ever heard. But you know, I can relate to both topics. I'm pagan, and there's a lot of magical words in that one. And then, what was the one? I call it the 30s poem.
It
was
Aging Millennial Blues.
Yeah, I can just relate to that. There's a book out there called Baby Boomer Generation Sociopaths. Read it. It's just like, just the frustrations with poverty, the frustrations with the phone, and just everything. And the Old American poem was great too. Could I actually get copies of both of those three I mentioned?
Can you have my set list for the night? Yes.
So you know there's like two defenestrations of Prague, right? Where they push people out of windows?
I just like the word.
It's a great word.
I love how the sword fight has degenerated into a workshop session. And that's totally awesome because the whole point was never to be all like, you suck. It was like, we can all be awesome.
Yes.
So thank you all very much. Give everybody a round of applause. I think Daria has a word.
I do.
It says Derek makes open challenger for August.
Oh, right. August. I'm still waiting to hear the name of this supposed challenger I will be facing in my debut match here in the sword fighting league. So, Azrael.
Not confirmed yet.
Not
still waiting.
That's why it's an open challenge. That's unfortunate because you see, I know that last month Yoli was running her mouth a little bit. didn't end up getting on camera, but all of us were a little tongue tied that night. That happens. I would be very happy to give JM another chance to redeem himself if that is what he'd be interested in. I am also interested in facing off with the winner here. I came here to play, and I didn't come here to play with Scrubs.
Oh shit!
I want the best. Yoli, if you can hear me at home, I mean you too, lady.
All right, so you heard it here. There's an open call out to challenge Daria in August, so that might be one of us. So, I think, we have just one last thing to do this evening, and that's, in addition to buying stuff back there, you know, because there's all kinds of poetry books and the stuff that I made by hand, we're also going to have an open mic.